Thank you very much for still being with us in this Sunday afternoon. So the session is going to be conducted in English, but the questions, the Q&A session, or if you want to be involved in the discussion, then you can ask questions in Chinese or Malay. We can try to translate from here. So as a moderator of today, so let me do my job by introducing the speakers first, because or else I will forget. I'm so sorry about the technical issues and all the things that that hasn't been going on so smoothly for the past 2 days, and I really thank you for your understanding. But I'm really glad that we had this film festival that allowed me to have such kind of gathering, actually, and the pleasure of watching such good films from Malaysia, and have a discussion with the scholars from Malaysia and also the filmmakers. And for this session, actually, the title is about anxiety in Malaysian cinema. 有关马来西亚电影的焦虑. So to touch upon the title of this the entire film festival, they we came across, because me, myself, and Zikri and Cheng, we three of us were the curators, and Prof Lim Kenke was the one who came up with the idea that we should have a Malaysian film festival here at NCTU, since we have such a good theater with the DCP player, and we are here, so why don't we just make one? So so we talk about what kind of film festival that we want to make, a contemporary Malaysian film festival, but what is Malaysian films, what is Malaysian cinema? So each of us have a different idea about it, so we have different connections as well, and different experience of watching Malaysian movies. So this is what it turned out to be, and please, we will be really happy to hear about your opinions after this 3 days event. So for this forum, it's about the anxiety in Malaysian cinema, because when we thought about what title that we should use, Zikri was the first one to propose that maybe we can use the anxiety, because all the films that we have watched, it seems like they're the tension, anxiety, the feelings of uneasiness in it, in every film. So whether it is the gender issues, the race tension, racial segregation, or the poverty, a lot, or about the non-linear time, the mystery part, a lot of things. So I think in this forum, we want to further problematize the discourse about Malaysian cinema. When we talk about Malaysia, firstly, what came to our mind would be the nation state itself, which is called Malaysia. But in this film festival, we also try to look for the possibility to go beyond that framework of a national narrative, because it is very complicated to actually understand what are the substance inside Malaysian cinema. Because Malaysian cinema also, they are inclusive of different linguistic sphere. Tamil cinema, Chinese cinema, Sinophone cinema, Malay cinema. So what kind of cinema are we talking about? So, and I'm really happy that, before I forget, we have these four speakers sitting beside me, and they are going to touch upon these issues that I've raised, that we have raised in the abstract that we have written in the panel discussion. So we have first Professor Khoo, Cheng, who is from Nottingham University, Malaysia, and Associate Professor of Film and Television, where she teaches Southeast Asian cinema and post-colonial theory and post-humanism. And Prof. Khoo, she has talked in the first day of lecture about Dean Said's film. So that day also, many questions were brought up about the temporality in a film, the traditional values when it comes across the modernity time, and that kind of tension that was being raised. So our second speaker, Dr. Norman, who is from University Technology Mara, where he teaches film studies. Professor Norman, very interestingly, I'm sorry I wasn't a good moderator yesterday when I introduced him, because the reason we invite Dr. Norman is also because he has been important work that he has done in Malaysia is the Wayang Budiman fortnightly screening session that he has been doing in Shah Alam in Selangor, Malaysia, where he curates the screening program for students from the public every 2 weeks. So it's a constant effort that he has been trying to reach out to the public to talk about films. And so maybe today he can talk more about the institutionalization of the film, Malaysian film industry. So we also have Professor T. Kim Tong from National Sun Yat-sen University, Department of Foreign Language and Literature. So his fields of interest include like culture studies, modernism, Sinophone and Anglophone, Southeast Asian literature. He's the author of many books, especially those in Chinese Malaysian literature. But he also works on films. So and the next speaker is Professor Lim Kiat Kiat, who is currently associate professor at the National Chatham University, this campus. He used to serve as the editor-in-chief of Film Appreciation Academic Journal of the Chinese Taipei Film Archive. So he also has been working on Chinese Malaysian literature and films. So without further ado, I think we can start with, so the sequence goes like this. We have each speaker to speak for about 15 minutes about questions that they want to raise or comments on for 15 minutes. And after that, we will open up the floor for discussion, and then we will hear them say more about questions that were raised. So let's start with Prof. Khoo.
Okay, hi. I'm going to try and keep it short because I actually would really love to hear from the audience because you get a nice wide array of Malaysian films in different languages, so I'm very, very curious about what you think of Malaysian films. Okay, I'm actually going to talk about, we were given some questions around maybe thinking about the changes in the film industry. When I first started writing about independent filmmakers in Malaysia, that was like 2004, 2005 when I started doing my fieldwork. So that first wave would be people like Tan Chee Mui, James Lee, Amir Muhammad, Wu Mingjin. So that's the first wave, and that's more than 10 years ago. So what has changed? And I think, first of all, if we just look at the technology, there's some really good positive things about using digital technology. I mean, the indies were the first ones who used digital equipment, and it democratized production. It made editing a lot easier, more portable, and and rental of film equipment as well made all those things cheaper. So you can see how, like last year, in terms of film production, it has increased. So last year, I heard that over 100 Malaysian films competed in the Malaysian Film Festival, the local Malaysian Film Festival. So what happened is, back in the early 2000s, mid-2000s, mainstream films that were kind of made in Malay, that targeted mostly Malay audiences, they were still shooting on 35mm. But then once is it like the Avatar effect, when cinemas decided they would put in digital projectors, right, because they could get more money in animation and all that kind of stuff, So they realized, oh, we can also make films in a much cheaper way. So now mainstream films are also made using digital.
The bad thing, the bad side to digital is that it can make filmmakers less disciplined. So, you know, especially those who are not trained using 35mm, right? So where you're much more disciplined because a film is money, as a filmmaker pointed out the other day. And the other thing is that it also drives down the overall budgets for production. So producers or film companies think that, oh, well, I can hire a director for much less because the whole overall budget is only this much. So if you show that you can do amazing stuff on a small budget and you are going to make a second film, your chances are maybe they might think, well, I don't have to give you so much so much money because you can do a lot with what you already have, you know, but you just look at your first film, right? So that's the problem, I think, because you can see, I think, in all the different industries, in advertising, that there are low rates. People are using new graduates, and they are unwilling to pay for the craft or the experience of filmmakers like James Lee, who, when he first started out, you know, was self-taught. And the thing with James is that he just kept going. So he moved from independent filmmaking into making mainstream Malay films in Malay horror. And then, you know, lo and behold, the last few years couldn't get a job as a director because, you know, he says that people won't pay for experience and the craft, right? They don't really appreciate the experience that you have that go into it. They're more willing to hire somebody who is lean and hungry and a new graduate. So if you look at the TV industry, because it's hard to be a filmmaker, so you have to make money by doing other things, whether it's working, making commercials, or corporate videos, or, you know, working in TV. Even in the TV industry, the budgets, the salaries have been stagnant since 1980s. This is what Naman was telling us last night. And therefore, you have very poor quality films. So, and the problem too is that it affects everything, right? Your crew, the directors, the actors, the people who are doing your hair, you know, they're just, actors get overexposed because they have to take many jobs and because the salaries are low, right? So they have no choice but to act in films and in TV that, you know, in roles that are not so good for them. Now, going on to the more positive side, the introduction of online platforms has been a positive thing for filmmakers because now you have online platforms like Vue, iFlix, and Netflix that will pay much more than the local private stations like Astro or TV3 or the other private stations. So, for example, Namar mentioned that The Bridge, which is the TV series, based, you know, from the original Norwegian Swedish series. No, sorry, not Norwegian, not Swedish. Oh, sorry, that can kill me. Danish. So The Bridge is adapted to be between Malaysia and Singapore, and directed by a Malaysian director who's mostly working in Singapore now, Tianjin, and The Bridge, to make one episode for Vue, they'll give you between 100 and 200,000 ringgit per episode. Whereas the local, the other TV stations will pay maybe 30 to 40,000 a day, an episode. Okay, so if you have these online platforms that are willing to pay more, that means that maybe it will force the local TV stations to pay more, to be much more competitive. So in that way, I think Chu Mui was saying that it's actually a good time now for filmmakers. They can have some choices. Netflix is busy looking for local content. So if you go to Netflix, you see Malaysian films like Pascal, Wan Tu Jaga, Pulang, etc.
Another online platform is Wubi.com. So Wubi.com is more well known for having caring art films. There is a plan to have a Nusantara selection, so films from Southeast Asia. So there's another alternative exhibition or distribution. Okay, in terms of continuity, you know, what's happened since the first wave of digital filmmakers? A curator once said from Rotterdam that so the Malaysian indies made it big in 2006-2007. You had people like Yasmin Ahmad and Tan Chin Muin, and then followed by Liu Singtat and various a few other ones. But then it died. You know, so for 1 or 2 years, Malaysian films were circulating in film festivals. And then after that, you know, the Filipinos got in there, and they're quite consistent. The Thais, because of the political circumstances, have become much more daring in some ways, not just in terms of making social realists, but being able to make experimental films mainstream. Being able to have these sort of crossover films that are independent in art cinema, but that have mainstream elements and the potential to be mainstream. So in Malaysia, we don't really have that so much. But perhaps now things are changing, hopefully. Maybe in Malaysia, it takes us, independent filmmakers make one film once every 5 years, maybe. Whereas in the Philippines, they like Alex Rudolfo. This is a guy who makes like 3-4 films in a year, and they're all different genres, different types. Yeah, so we're not as hungry as the Filipinos, and not as creative as the Thais, unfortunately. But there are new players. So we have, they're new, but they're not that new in the sense that they're new on the scene for those of us who don't know what's happening locally. But they're actually people who have been working behind the scenes. So Tan Seng Kiat's Shuttle Life, he was the assistant director for Liu Singtat's first film, Flower in the Pocket. And you have Sanjay, and then maybe younger ones, well, Seng Kiat, but maybe also people like Zahir Omar, whose film Fly By Night is now out. And very interestingly, Zahir Omar's film is a Mandarin language film, a gangster heist film, with some of the actors from Shadow Life and a very famous stuntman turned actor, Sunny Pang, who was made famous by James Lee, I think. So you then also have, because there have been workshops where I think we have to acknowledge Tan Chin Mui's help in mentoring younger filmmakers to come up under this whole idea of looking for the next new wave. So there have been workshops together with some funding from FINAS and Astro to get people like Amanda Nell Yu, who short film won prize, and she's managed to get some development funding support to make her first feature coming up. And so she's a name to look up for, because I think she's very much a feminist filmmaker in a very masculine environment. We've seen a lot of violence so far in the last few days. There's also Ao Siwi. So if you read the credits on Shuttle Life, he's the second assistant director, I think. Then there'll be more films coming out. So you've got these sort of indie from the first wave that have connections to Ta Huang, and then you have Amir leaving Ta Huang and going off to become a publisher and a very successful one, and then coming back by making a documentary, and then now becoming like Roger Corman in forming Kuman Pictures, right? So Amir Mohammed is now he's got a plan to make. So as the producer, as the producer of Kuman Pictures, he is funding thriller, psychological horror, thriller/horror. So the first three films, and they're very low budget, and they operate in a different system. They operate on a, what do you call it, royalties system. So he will give royalties to everybody who worked on the film. So the first three films that are coming out this year, the first one's directed by James Lee, and it's in Mandarin. The second one is directed by Amira Aswan in Malay, and then there will be a Tamil language one. So he's very multicultural, which he said it wasn't planned that way, but somehow, you know, that's what happened. So that would be something to look at. The other thing too is you had people like Bron Pillare, who produced Namron's One to Jaga. But Bron himself was acting in The Bridge, and he's doing other things and also kind of making other films, and has been acting in other films that are could be considered Malay indie. So there's another group of people, the Rewan Ishak, who made Kill and made Mustafa. And you can recognize them because there's a certain look of their films, right? That are kind of indie. That there's the colors that they use, very hipster. And I think that the other, because I say this again, that a lot of the filmmakers are Malay, are male. So the films are very masculinist. Not that there's anything wrong with it, because some of the stories are, you know, they affect us all. But there are women filmmakers coming up that tell the films from women's perspectives. And another woman filmmaker it will be interesting to look at is Nadia Hamza, who's going to have a feature coming out soon. She's only made a short film or a few short films before this. Okay, so the landscape is very diverse, as you probably gather already from the films you've seen. But we also have people that I haven't mentioned, like Yasu Tanaka, very Japanese name because he is Japanese, but married to a Malaysian. So they, husband and wife, team work together, they write the script together, and the films are based in Malaysia and are Malaysians, right? Because Nota is a thriller, a Malay language thriller, and I think they're working on something as well and trying to get funding. So I think to end, in terms of the filmmaking styles, this is kind of what you see, you know, the kind of move towards a more Dardenne Brothers, very gritty social realism with some elements of genre. And they're more mainstream. The kind of mainstreamness has always, the desire to go mainstream has always been there, right, from the beginning. So we're just only starting to see that explosion or that exploration of these sort of mainstream films. So if we compare to Filipino films, I think we're more mainstream. Our indies are more mainstream than theirs. What else? We're not experimental, unfortunately. Even though every year we have the KL Experimental Film Festival, but they're very short films, and they're mostly run by people who are in the experimental music scene. So that tells you a lot. And I suspect it has to do with our training, because in Thailand they do have art and experimental film, and in the Philippines as well, and that's not something that we have or cultivate, unfortunately. So if you look at the people who do make experimental films, they're now no longer making experimental films. So Chris Chong, Sabahan filmmaker who made Karaoke, I think he's now just mostly doing video installations. He had pitched to make a documentary many years ago, but then I think it didn't pan, couldn't get the funding. You have Kamal Sabran, he must be an artist. So his short film is in the 15 Malaysia shorts. If you can go online, you can see them. But again, you know, not really consistent because people are caught up with trying to just survive. And my last thing, and Zhang Yingyang is not here, so I can say this, is that I think that the Malaysians who make films in Malaysia have, because of the difficulty of getting funding, have a deep respect for what it's like to be a producer, or to raise money. And even producers themselves, like B. Tanaka, the Nota writer, the husband and wife team, you know, it's to make a film is basically a labor of love because you get so little back in terms of, you know, the finances. And we heard that from Namron last night. You're lucky to get some money back. So it's not like you're making these films to make a lot of money, especially if you're an indie filmmaker. So indie filmmakers, feel they have this sense of obligation or responsibility because people put their trust in you, they put their money in your project. So you can't just sort of diss them off and do your own thing. So so fortunately or unfortunately, filmmakers don't take those economic risks or those artistic risks because it's somebody else's money. Right? So if it's your own money and you're like do or die, then you can kind of, you know, not worry so much. Or if you're young and naive and just finished, just finished school or whatever. So. Yeah, I think I'll stop there and let the rest of you.
Hello, everyone. I would like to just briefly touch a bit on the idea of Malaysian cinema in general before I want to proceed with specific focus. Generally, what makes the Malaysian cinema, or what constitutes the Malaysian cinema? Malaysian cinema, because yesterday I talked about the history and development of Malaysian cinema through the use of genre. Malaysian cinema, I would like to divide Malaysian cinema into three phases or stages. The earliest one is during the golden age of Malay cinema, which began in Singapore. Singapore and Malaysia both share a similar film history. And there were about two studios in Singapore, Shaw Brothers and Pitik Reis, as well as after the closing down of the two studios, and the film industry, the Malay film industry, moved to Kuala Lumpur, where Studio Merdeka was set up. And all the film personalities and stars all moved to Kuala Lumpur, including P. Ramli. And then, so during this, in Malay language discourse, this era is labeled as a studio era. Era studio. And then the second one, and then we had the second one began in 1975 after the death of Ramli in 1973, and then there's like kind of a hiatus between 73 and 75, and then 75 there was a production house emerged, Sabah Film Production, and made a comedy, a genre film titled Clover Chomat. And then also during this period, 75 to 1999, I would call it independent era, but not independent in the sense of this digital independent filmmaking, which emerged later. Post-millennial era, but independent in the sense that non-studio kind of our system, where it witnessed a number of or mushrooming of production houses or production companies, mostly owned by the Bumi Putra, the Malaysian Bumi Putra. This is very much in tandem with the government's policy and the introduction of the new economic policy in 1971 to encourage the Malaysians especially to involve in business.